Nevertheless, listening since morning, I think a lot of areas have already been covered. I will not try to broach upon that. But looking at the crisis in agriculture and also the idea behind bringing second green revolution or to India and bringing the green revolution to the Northeast is, I think, something that I'd like to focus upon. For that, I'll have to take you in circles to complete the story of green revolution. But before I do that, I present two scenarios before you. In the mid-80s, the International Rice Research Institute published two studies. I don't think these studies are ever talked about. One study said that if you are using a knapsack sprayer on your back and spraying pesticide on your crop, or if you keep pesticide at the source of irrigation water in your crop field, there is no difference in the efficiency of the pesticide. The second study says that if you are broadcasting rice or if you are transplanting rice, there is no difference in productivity. This was in the mid-80s. Then came the era of WTO in 1995. After that, study, and everywhere I go, I used to see this argument that in a globalized world, the Indian farmer would be pushed out of agriculture or would be left behind unless he competes or is globally competitive with the American farmer or with the Chinese farmers. Now, these two studies, or those two statements, have a lot of relation with Green Revolution. Now let me try to explain why I presented these two before you. The first study that I mentioned, two studies in fact, that the International Rice Research Institute did. When I was a student of agriculture, and I am sure when many of you have been students of agriculture or are studying agriculture, we have been made to believe that it's very important to ensure pesticide efficient use efficiencies. So if you are spraying on cotton, if you are spraying on sugarcane, if you are spraying on apple, you know, its efficiency is very important. So what you need is a knapsack sprayer, and on top of it you need nozzles. So you have at least 10-15 different kinds of nozzle. So you, when you spray on apple, it's a different nozzle. When you spray on sugarcane, it's a different nozzle. When you spray on wheat, it's a different nozzle. Now the question comes up then, why were we asked to go in for knapsack sprayers? Similarly, we were told that, you know, if you want to be an efficient farmer, paddy farmer, you want to increase your productivity, you must go in for transplantation. But then the study now says very clearly that there is no difference in the productivity if you go by broadcasting or if you go by transplanting. The question that comes to your mind is, then why were we asked to go in for transplantation? I posed this question to my friend and one of the world's best known rice scientists, Dr. Gurudev Ghosh, when I was at the International Rice Research Institute. Gurudev Ghosh was very nice. He thought for some time and then he replied to me. He said, "Devinder, actually we were trying to help the tractor industry. Because when the dwarf varieties of paddy came in, the tractor had also come into place. Now the problem is that tractor's marketing has, of course, is something that the industry would be keen for, but 97% of rice is grown in Asia. Now if the tractor sales have to pick up in Asia, the tractor must go into the rice field. But if you are broadcasting, the tractor is likely to trample the plants. So it's going to impact your crop. So therefore you will not be very excited to go in for a tractor. So to ensure that the tractor gets into the rice field, the scientists did a marvelous job. They actually taught us or improved what was known as transplanting earlier also and made it a uniform pattern all across the country. So we went into a transplanting paddy not knowing whether it really increases your productivity, but because it helped the tractor industry. And so once it helps the industry, there's all kinds of justification for it, we all know that. And then when I built upon that theory, I realized that when in Punjab the tractors came in, the tractors would come in with a package. You know, it's always with a package. Whenever the industry has to sell in, it will come up with a package. The package would entail that if you, you know, the full page advertisement that would appear in the newspapers then would show a Punjab farmer with his pagri on, with his moustache up, you know, and said that progressive farmer. So progressive farmer, what you need is a tractor. So tractor, you sir, you must take loan from the bank or whatever, and but a tractor is very important. So every farmer started looking for if he could afford a tractor. The tractor, which was a symbol of progress at that particular time, today has become a symbol of suicide in Punjab. Every second household in Punjab today has a tractor, agriculture household has a tractor. The scientists or the economists tell us that for a tractor to be economically viable, you need a minimum area of 10 acres to begin with. Now, over the years, that has been reduced, you know, by the industry pressure to 2 acres. So if you have 2 acres, you just have to go, if you have 500 rupees in your pocket, you just go to the agent and you will get a tractor. He will garland the tractor, he will garland you and show the tractor is delivered. And you are very happy, you have become a progressive farmer. If you want to buy a second-hand tractor almost new, you must go to Bathinda. Bathinda is the cotton belt of Punjab. What the farmers do is, you know, when he has to get his daughter married, for instance, the best thing he does is, because he can't afford to give a car in dowry, so he goes and buys a tractor, because all he needs is 500 rupees. So he goes, buys a tractor, which may cost 5 lakh rupees, but he gets some credit, and after 10 days he will sell it off, he will get at least 3 lakh rupees, buy a Alto, and give it for his daughter's marriage. So the tractor is available to you if you really want a second-hand tractor, almost a new tractor. Now that cycle has been going on. Now the burden is passed on to the farmer, the company is very happy. Now I understand that the entire movement of tractor, the industry is now moving on into the West Bengal and also to the Northeast. And they are now even in fact going a step ahead. Earlier they would have their agents who will do the marketing for them. Now they have the agriculture scientists who do the marketing for them. Because now they have the tie-up with the agriculture universities to promote tractors. So universities are doing the job which the agents would do some years back for them. So remarkable job done by the tractor industry, not only in the North India but also in the South India now, where the industry is now getting into collaboration with the agriculture science. Now these instances will tell you where we have moved on, and when we talk of this technology, why have we moved on to such a stage that agriculture has become what is called as unremunerative. Let's look at this use of technology. One example which I often give is the example of cows. We are a land of holy cows. We are proud of holy cows, I think only in scriptures. But otherwise I find lots of cows roaming on the streets in Calcutta, in Chandigarh, in Delhi. Wherever you go, Indian cows, especially Desi breeds, you find them on the streets. I always used to wonder when I was a student, why is it that I have not been, nobody seems to be very proud of Indian breeds of cows. You know, suddenly you are mesmerized with Jersey and Holstein Friesian. You believe that unless you import them and crossbreed with your own cows, your productivity will not go up. We have been made to believe, if you go back to the era of the White Revolution, we have been made to believe that you have to bring all these improved varieties from outside because they are high milk producers. Crossbreed with your Desi cows, which they don't produce, so on and so forth. I didn't get the answer. 2 years back, I happened to be in Brazil, where they invited me, knowing that I was there. One province organized a milk competition for me. I went into the milk competition. It was a 3-day milk competition. 80 cows participated in that milk competition. After 3 days, when I was invited to give the first prize or the prizes, the man who got the first prize got for a cow, which was a pure breed, Gir from Gujarat. Gir from Gujarat clocked 48.8 liters to get the first prize in Brazil. The second prize went to again Gir from Gujarat with 45 liters. The third prize went to Kankrej from that same region with 42 liters. And the fourth prize went to Jersey with 41 liters. The man who got the first prize walked up to me and then he asked me while he was getting that award, he said, "Sir, I understand this cow comes from India." I said, "Yes, you are right." He said, "Please tell me, have I matched the milk potential of your country or do I still need to do more?" I felt so ashamed that in India, we don't talk of Gir, we don't talk of the local breeds, we only talk of Jersey and Holstein Friesian. Now, sadly, or whatever reason you can say, Brazil has now become the biggest exporter of Indian breeds of cows. you know, and not only Jersey, you know, you name it across, right from Sahiwal to Jersey to Kankresh to Ongole, they have developed all those breed pure breed, and they are exporting to Africa, to Asia, and I'm sure in the days to come we will also be importing our own breeds now from Brazil. Lately my data has also been improved. I got a recent mail which told me that the highest milk producer deer today in the world is now a Brazilian cow clocking 62.2 liters. 62.2 liters is pure bred deer from India. That cow alone is worth $2 million, what is being said. Now you will agree that cow, if it was existing in India, or let's say we had developed our own local breeds, you know, that would have been a very economically viable way of developing your agriculture. You know, because these local breeds adapt to your conditions, they know, they have less diseases, you know, and all those kinds of stress conditions and so on and so forth. But when you bring in Jersey and Holstein Friesian, if you ever been to a pure Jersey farm, you will find each cow has a tube light, each cow has a shower, each cow has a fan. And if you are in conditions where there is very hot, it also has air conditioners. I think this is something which is a luxury for most of our farmers in India. Now these are the conditions, but you know, our scientists are very happy, so are the policy makers, trying to bring all the exotic breeds and trying to tell us that you can improve your milk production by this system. And what has happened over the years is that we have 30 breeds of cows, location specific, very important for each particular area. I think half of them are lost. We don't even know. 80% of our cows which roam these streets are non-descript animal because they have gone into you know, excessive crossbreeding. We don't even know which breed they come from. The only point I'm trying to make is that if our scientists had worked on our own breeds, probably we would have really been proud of Indian cows, and we would have been the land of woody cows. Now this was not only confined to cows. If you look around, something happened that, you know, we felt ashamed of our agriculture. I'm taking you back to the era of pre-Green Revolution days, when our scientists began working on the new technology that we talked about. Suddenly I realized that when I was a student, that somehow if you were to read Indian history of India's agriculture, and M.S. Randhawa has written 4 excellent volumes, if you can ever find time to go into it, you know, you feel very proud of what Indian kings were doing and how Indian agriculture was vibrant, so were the cattle and animals and so on and so forth. But what happened suddenly after independence, that we became so ashamed of our production systems, of our agriculture. Now this essentially began from what was mentioned in the morning today, the land grant system of education. The land grant system of education enabled India to get the universities on the pattern of American universities from Ohio, from California and so on to begin with, and Pantnagar was the first university that came up under the land grant system of education. That university was set up by USAID, and if you know what USAID stands for, I'm sorry, but I take it differently. It is the US Artificial Insemination Department. They do a remarkable job wherever they go in artificial insemination, their thoughts as well as their purpose across the country, across the globe. Now having done that, the first university that came up at Pantnagar, followed by other states, you know, the entire curriculum was designed, the structure was designed on the trimester system of education, where extension, education and research were the 3 major subjects. And also the curriculum came from those universities. That's very fascinating again. I don't know, how many of you are agriculture students here? What book did you study on soil science? You remember? Yes. I also studied the same book, Soil Science by Buckman and Brady. I think in my time it was Buckman and Brady. I am told one of them is dead now, so it's probably only Brady left. But you know, that particular book, at that time when I was a student, I'm talking of the 70s, that time it was an American edition. Now the difference I find is you have the Indian editions. But you know, the book actually is not written for Indian soils. The book actually is written for temperate soils. It has been a textbook for us all these years, knowing that temperate and tropical are quite different. I thought we should have known that. But somehow we have been educating our people on borrowed ideas, not only on borrowed ideas, but also on borrowed curriculum. Now, interestingly, all through my days of studies, and I'm sure yours, we were never taught to focus on something called as earthworm. Earthworm was a collateral damage of the intensive farming model that we developed. You know, you use more chemical fertilizer, more pesticides, and one thing which disappears from the soil, which you can see from visibly see, is of course the earthworm. But nobody asked this question, are the earthworms important? And whenever I would pose that question to my professors, I would get this stock reply that you don't have to worry about earthworm because we need to raise production. And of course, since we need to raise production, we forgot about the earthworm. 40 years later, I found that we again went back to earthworm in the form of vermicompost. What is vermicompost? It's the compost of the worms. Now, 40 years we forgot, we made the earthworm disappear from our croplands. And then we came up, set up an industry of vermicompost, which is now providing compost, earthworm compost to the crop field. But then how come Indian scientists forgot about earthworm? It's something which has been always worrying me. You know, why didn't we realize that earthworm role is very important, even if we have to dig it out again after 40 years? You know, I got a rude shock when a couple of years back I read a Reuters report which said that America also realized that earthworm is important. So 2 years back or 4 years back, I don't know which period, they actually imported earthworm from Africa into their soils. And that earthworm going into America became a nuisance in their environment. You know, this is what happens, as Pushpa Bhargava was telling in the morning, you know, when we import alien species, it becomes alien invasive species. So earthworm became alien invasive species for America. Now why? Actually, in America, except for the Yellowstone parks and so on, earthworm does not exist in the croplands. Earthworm does not exist in the croplands. There are reasons for it. One, ecologically, it is not a conducive environment for them, because there is a half of the year it's all under snow, and then otherwise also the temperature of the soil is minus 10, minus 20, and so on and so forth. The earthworm cannot survive. So the American scientists did not talk about the earthworm. The point I'm trying to make is, just because the American scientists did not talk about the earthworm, our scientists also forgot to talk about the earthworm. Now that is the problem that agriculture faces. When you look into crisis in agriculture, I think we have to see who has created that problem, who has ignored the realities of the Indian agriculture all these years, and why have we tried to bring in a kind of alien agriculture, impose it on us. Now, often this question is asked, and I remember when Borlaug was alive, he would debate with me endlessly on this. Since I was the agriculture correspondent of Indian Express, would always get a chance to travel with him to Punjab and Haryana whenever he would come to India. In my discussions with him, we would go on to discussion, and he was very passionate about this issue that, you know, we have to raise productivity, which has been his essence. Now, at one time, I remember he telling me that if India had not gone in for Green Revolution, and I'm sure you have read this figure again and again, we would have required 58 million hectares more to produce the same kind of food that we would have produced or we required to produce. Several years later, several decades later, before he died, I and he were debating at the Royal Institute in London the aftermath of Green Revolution. Of course, he was Borlaug and I was a non-entity, but we debated. And when I was debating, I told him, yes, it is true that if India had not gone in for Green Revolution, we would have required 58 million hectares more. But the fact of the matter is, 40 years after Green Revolution, 130 million hectares is faced with varying degrees of degradation in India. So this is the cost that we have paid over the years. But to say that, you know, this is something that it was inevitable, we must do it, I think it runs into not only his fascination for pesticides and fertilizer, but also beyond that, he would also castigate everyone who would question that kind of methodology or question that system. I remember once asking him a question about pesticides, and if you remember that book Rachel Carson had brought out, Silent Spring, I asked him a question. I said, what do you have to say about Rachel Carson's book, Silent Spring? She said, she is a terrorist. These are the people who don't want the poor to be fed. These are the people who actually want to keep the world hungry. Anyway, his argument was that pesticides are like medicines, and they have to be taken as carefully as medicines are. And so therefore, there's nothing wrong with pesticides. Of course, now the entire world, including the science that we talk about, genetic engineering, which we are all critical about, is also actually trying to solve the problem of pesticide pollution, you know, by the new technology. So there is although Borlaug would deny that, but the fact of the matter was that, as I said earlier, quoting David Pimentel, pesticides were actually not required. They were a byproduct of the Second World War, and the industry wanted to use it. So they found their usage was very good in agriculture. So that is where they pushed. Why I'm saying is they were not required is, you know, 40 years after Green Revolution, the main citadel of Green Revolution, one of the main seats of Green Revolution was the International Rice Research Institute, which did a study. And I remember the study said very clearly, Robert Cantrell, the then Director General of IRI, who sat with me on several committees, would go on talking about it. He said, and I quote, he said, "We now realize that pesticides in Asia are a waste of time and effort." He said, "We now realize that pesticides on rice in Asia are a waste of time and effort. Farmers in Vietnam, farmers in Cambodia, farmers in Bangladesh, farmers in India have proved that you can grow a higher crop of rice without using pesticides." These are the words of International Rice Research Institute. I thought IRI, which gives you all the wherewithal for technological research within the country, should have ensured that the Indian scientists also follow the dictum that pesticides on rice are not required. But somehow I never found this in the debate in India. No scientist has ever stood up and said that pesticides on rice are not required and should be stopped, and we should go in for integrated pest management and so on. But nevertheless, the point I'm trying to take on is, or to trying to build on is, that these technologies were pushed in because there was an industrial interest behind it. And because there was an industry behind it, the scientists were also on the same bandwagon trying to promote those technologies which were benefiting the industry. The focus or the thrust was not the farmer. Farmer was just happened to be the one whom you could have perhaps facilitate that process. But actually the interest was to promote the interest of the industry. Everything centered around how to promote a particular brand of fertilizer. You know, when you have to push potash into India, you set up an Indian Potash Institute. It's very fascinating. You look into the kind of research in India. Whenever they have to set up, promote something in India, they first would set up an institute. That institute will give a certificate. Yes, potash is required in the Indian soils. And then, of course, you will have potash coming into India. Similarly, the micronutrients. There are now 15, 16 micronutrients that the soil requires after being depleted because of the intensive farming systems. So we have the institutes now which promote micronutrients, which tell you that, you know, microbalance use of chemical fertilizer, and so on and so forth, to justify that you start using all those micronutrients also. So anyway, the thrust is that, you know, you must use help the industry to grow out of it. Now, 45 years after Green Revolution began in 1966, the seeds were sown in 1966 by Mrs. Indira Gandhi. Now, the fact of the matter is, 45 years we were told by agriculture scientists and the economists, don't forget the role of economists ever. The economists told us that, you know, the more you sow, the more is your productivity, the more will be your income. I'm sure you have heard it already, So we have been telling farmers that, you know, you going for intensive farming system, more chemical fertilizer, more pesticides, more hybrids, the more your productivity will go up, the more will be your income. So what is the average income of a farming family after 45 years of Green Revolution? The National Sample Survey Organization did this only once. In 2003-2004, they first time computed what is the average farm income in this country. The average farm income, they found out monthly farm income in 2003-2004, according to the NSSO, was ₹2,115. After 45 years of Green Revolution, the average income of a farming family per month was ₹2,114, which included ₹900 for non-farm activities also. There were only three states above it. Above the national average, only three states: J&K, Punjab, and Tamil Nadu. Rest all were below that average, which means Bengal was also below that average, which means your farmers are still not above the poverty line. If you are living in Calcutta or live in Delhi, I think for a maid servant who comes to clean your house for 1 hour in the morning, you pay her a minimum of at least ₹2,000. And here is one family with five members of a family intact, you know, earning only, if they're working 24/7, the average income is only ₹2,115. That means the model of agriculture that our economists glorified was something which did not deliver. Let's accept it. Let's be honest. Let's be feel also ashamed that 45 years after Green Revolution, the farmer lives where he was. you know, and that is why that subsistence farming thing they talk about. Then why is it that the American farmer, the European farmer, the farmer in Australia is doing so well? Because after all, the scale is different, but we follow the same farming model. Then why is it that the American farmer does well, the Indian farmer does not, you know, do equally well? That is why the WTO agreement, the argument comes in, that in a globalized world, if Indian farmer has to be making his money or making himself become competitive or economically viable, then he has to be globally competitive, means reaching the same productivity standards as in America. I think this was completely wrong. Again, our economist gave it wrong to us. Wherever I go in a conference, I find agriculture scientists nodding their head when they are told that there's no way out than to raise productivity. Now let us look at the American productivity for instance. In America today, there are only 7 lakh farmers left, which is less than 1% of the population of America. America's population is about 320 million. We have, in India, we have 320 million people who go to bed hungry. In America, we have 320 million people, total population. Only less than 1% population is involved in agriculture. Let's make a comparison with paddy, because paddy is your crop in West Bengal. Paddy is also a crop in America, not the major crop. The total output of paddy in America is worth $1.2 billion. Total output, $1.2 billion. Average productivity, 7 tons per hectare. In India, largest area in the world under paddy is in India. The average productivity is 3 tons per hectare. So obviously every scientist would say that is why farmers commit suicide. You know, unless he can raise his productivity level to 7 tons, he cannot survive. That's the argument you find everywhere. And I think agriculture scientists and economists are again wrong. The American farmer, he produces a crop of $1.2 billion with 7 tons per hectare. He should be economically viable. Am I right? According to the argument that we have, he should be economically viable. But he can't survive unless the government gives him a corresponding subsidy. And what is the subsidy he gets? He gets a subsidy of $1.4 billion a year to produce a crop of $1.2 billion. Now, if Indian farmers were to raise their productivity from 3 tons to 7 tons, can government of India provide him the matching subsidy? In America, the rice farmer is alive today not because he is efficient, quote unquote, but he is alive because he gets direct income support from the state. In India, we have followed half the model. You know, we have brought fertilizer, pesticides, machinery and so on, but we haven't given him the economic part of that model also. We are very clever economists. We justify our own salaries only. We don't justify the salaries of the poor farmer. We've done it over the years. And I think, to me, it's also a part of the crime. We deliberately kept it low. Now look at cotton, for instance. You know, we know of cotton farmers dying in India. We know that 70% of those farmer suicides are now, since 1995, 2.7 lakh farmers have died till date in India. These are the farmers, out of which 70% are cotton growers. And we are told cotton is a cash crop. We brought in BT cotton with this assumption. Again, scientists and economists got together to mislead the country that the productivity goes up. Let me tell you, the BT cotton, BT gene does not increase productivity. BT gene does exactly what the chemical pesticides do, they reduce crop losses. If BT gene can increase productivity, pesticides too should be classified to have increased productivity. No scientist will ever accept that chemical pesticides increase productivity, they always reduce crop losses. But in this case of genetic engineering, we actually accept it because the industry wanted us to accept that, you know, BT would increase productivity. To mislead the people that it increases your productivity, actually it reduces crop losses. There's a difference between crop losses, reducing crop losses and increasing productivity, I think all of you know as scientists. But we did it. We did it and we said that average, I remember at that particular time when we opposed BT cotton and India got 1 year extension, forcing Monsanto and Myco to go in for 1 year more of trial. I was in that committee when we worked it out that this all data that the Monsanto company had given us was actually not correct. And that is why we went in for 1 year more of trials. Nevertheless, that time the DBT had said that 10,000 rupees per acre is the economic gain that will come about. And nobody ever talked about that from BT cotton, the water requirement will also go up by 20% or so. Nobody ever talked about that. And when I first talked about water requirement of BT going up, one scientist asked me a question, "You must be foolish," he said. "Water requirement should come down." That was the argument. But now I'm so glad it has been established that, you know, in the rain-fed areas, BT cotton was a mistake because the water requirement was more. So scientists now accept that the water requirement of BT goes up more than the hybrids in which the gene has been inserted. We were told that the productivity will go up, as a result of which the income will go up. Now, if that income had gone up all these years, I would have expected farmers to have less suicides happening in this country. But they forget about the debate whether the suicides happened because of BT cotton or not. But the fact of the matter is cotton was not a savior in India. Now let's look at what happens in America. In America, there are 20,000 cotton growers. In India, again, we have the largest area under cotton. In America, whatever be the yield, I think one of the highest yields exists in America. The American farmers in 2005, when I published this data, the American farmers produced a crop which was worth $3.9 billion. Total cotton, $3.9 billion. And how much did the subsidy the cotton farmers got? In 2005, they got a subsidy of $4.7 billion to produce a crop of $3.9 billion. And when eventually Brazil took them to dispute panel in WTO, challenging the subsidies that America gives for cotton, and America lost the case. America lost the case, so they thought the best way, instead of attracting more duties from Brazil as a countervailing part, they could have done it. So America bribed the cotton farmers in Brazil. America now provides, in addition to the subsidies they provide to cotton farmers in America, they also provide $147 million of subsidies to cotton farmers in Brazil. So your mouth is shut. What a clever way. And then we are told Indian farmer is inefficient and he doesn't know how to farm. The African farmer is inefficient, he doesn't know how to farm. If he were to raise his productivity, he would match the American standards and therefore he will be globally competitive. The assumption that we need to understand is, this is a model where lot depends upon how you perceive, how you understand as to what is being told to you, how you decipher the realities out of what is presented before you. Now, if you see the global model, look at the very clever way. I told you that they bribe $147 million subsidy to providing Brazilian cotton farmers with subsidy. They also ensure that they, to their own textile industry, they provide a subsidy of $180 million to keep the prices low. As a result of which, the prices of the yarn fall in America. The prices of the yarn in India, we are priced out. We look to be very inefficient, the industry as well as the farmers. Now look at the cotton farmers the other way also. Over the years, if you have ever carefully studied the CACT report, the problem with most of us is we don't read. We don't even read the newspapers. So I can't expect anyone to do that, but CACP reports, Commission for Agriculture, Cost and Prices, if you were to read those reports carefully, Kharif and Rabi reports, in fact in one report it was mentioned 10 years back, the report said that we have deliberately paid cotton farmers 20% less to keep the industry afloat. Which means Indian cotton farmers are actually subsidizing the textile industry, the Reliance and the other companies in India all these years, so that they can be globally competitive. 20% the farmers were paid less according to CSE. The pattern continues. And when the term came PPP, Public-Private Partnership, I thought the best and the classical way of looking at PPP is what happened to the case of cotton farmers. These farmers who has kept the industry afloat all these years, and when the cotton farmers started committing suicide, I thought the industry should stand up to bail out those farmers. But industry didn't do it. Industry said we'll import cotton from outside rather than to buy a price which at a higher price, because 2 years back the price was raised to 4,000 rupees. So they said we'll not buy it from India, we'll buy it from outside. This is exactly what is PPP. You know, as long as the private sector is subsidized, it is PPP. But when they have to shell out something, they will never stand up to that. And I can give you a number of examples on that, but that's a different issue. Now coming to Green Revolution. Now, why I'm suggesting all these things or mentioning all these things is because unless you see this picture or try to fit in all these arguments, you'll never be able to understand as to what happened in the case of Indian Green Revolution. You know, all of you know that India's Green Revolution, or let's say India's independence, came in the backdrop of the Bengal famine. This is a place which is historic in many ways. So let's go back to the era of Bengal famine. Amartya Sen tells us that in Bengal famine 1943, production did not fall. Production was less in 1941, but there was no famine. Famine occurred in 1943 because food was diverted. Food was diverted, the private trade had cornered that, millions died. That is what, and of course, we all know Kalahandi was the first shipment to Bengal came from Kalahandi, which is now, of course, established in the belt of India. Now, these are some stark realities that we need to understand. But in that backdrop, India got its independence. We were importing food under PL 480, as we all know. Not that Jawaharlal Nehru didn't try his best. In fact, I remember in one of his August 15 speeches, 1955, from the ramparts of the Red Fort, he had said, and we quote half the sentence, but we don't quote full sentence. The full sentence was, "It is very humiliating for any country to import food." You must listen to this. You have heard the second part again and again. "So everything else can wait, but not agriculture." Now we use only the second part of the sentence. We Finance Minister Chidambaram used to say, everything else can wait, but not agriculture. He didn't quote the first part. The first part is linked to it. He said, "It is very humiliating for any country to import food, so everything else can wait, but not agriculture." Jawaharlal Nehru tried his best. All the community programs and so on and so forth, but somehow it didn't happen. In 1965, when Lal Bahadur Shastri was a Prime Minister, we had the war with Pakistan, but we also had a drought in 1965. And Bengal that year actually had, I would call it a famine, in which about 2,000 plus people died in 1965 in Bengal. But nevertheless, in 1965, we had a drought, a severe drought, in which we imported about 10 million tons of food grains. Lal Bahadur Shastri died in January 1966. Mrs. Gandhi took over. Mrs. Gandhi again faced a drought year. 1966 was also a drought year. In that particular year, we imported 11 million tons of food grains under PL 480. This was the biggest food import at that time in history. And then came the era when, that was 1966, was also a time when Borlaug had developed his miracle wheat seeds and was trying to push wheat into India. And he was very sure that India is the right place for it. There was a debate in India at that time. Some scientists supported him, some didn't, and so on and so forth. But I remember asking Borlaug once, I said, "How did you manage to click in India?" He said, one of the approaches he followed was, he knew the rivalry between Pakistan and India. So he would play one against the other. So he went to Pakistan and said, "If you don't take wheat seed, I'm going to give it to India." To India, I said, "If you don't take wheat seed, I'm going to give it to Pakistan." So they both were in the race. So now what happens is, Mrs. Gandhi, as you all know, in October 1966, we got the first crop of, we sowed the first crop of the Dwar wheat seed that we got from Mexico. You will agree that Green Revolution, of course, is much written about, much talked about, and so on. But one of the things which always baffled me was that a program of the size of Green Revolution cannot happen unless there is a political will behind it. Now, what was that political will? So I asked once Dr. Swaminathan as to what was that political will that actually pushed in Green Revolution into India. It can't be just Borlaug wanted to sell his seats and you were keen to take on his seat. There must be political backing for it. And Swaminathan gave me a story which I don't know whether he narrates it or not, but his story was very fascinating. He said actually the entire history of Green Revolution, if you were to dub it, it would be written in a car journey. He was driving Mrs. Indira Gandhi when she was the Prime Minister. He was driving her to IARI, Indian Agriculture Research Institute, where he was the director, if you remember, and in that to inaugurate something. And he said, in that car journey, Mrs. Gandhi asked him a question. And I'm quoting him. He said, Mrs. Gandhi said, "Swami," that's what she used to call him, "Swami, would you give me a commitment? If I take this seed that you are trying to sell me, can you give me a surplus in a couple of years from now?" Again, the second part of the sentence is very important. Mrs. Gandhi said, "Because I want the bloody Americans off my back." Remember what Nehru said, it is very humiliating for any country to import food. And that's what Mrs. Gandhi was actually facing. You know, the arm twisting, all those hassles and humiliation that she must have undergone. So she was willing to take that risk to ensure that we become 18,000 tons of wheat seed from America. Now, let me make it clear, it was not certified wheat seed. What came to us from Mexico, not America, but Mexico City Cement, actually was not certified wheat seed. It was cleaned grain from the farmers' fields. You know, farmers were asked, because 18,000 ton was a big requirement and in a short time, so what India did was asking them to provide whatever grain they could provide, and that was clean, and what came to us was clean grain. It's not certified. It's another interesting development or another interesting study that we must do about the certified industry, seed industry that emerged later in India. And I have always been questioning, why do you need certified seed for wheat and rice when clean grain of wheat could bring in a revolution? Why do you need to certify seed and put the burden on the farmer? That is why most of the seed federations across the country have always been in red in this country, because they were not required. Nevertheless, we got the 18,000 tons of seed. And as Dendu said, prior to me, that seed was, they planned it out, this in 5 kilos packets, it was distributed to the farmers in the areas demarcated, in those irrigated areas they thought were the best equipped to do that. Punjab, Haryana were one state at that time, you know, part of eastern UP, part of western UP, maybe Bengal, some areas, and some in Andhra and so on. But by and large, this was the Green Revolution belt. Now, the first crop we got was a quantum jump. Normally, India's wheat production at that time was hovering around about 12 million tons. The first jump we got was 5 million tons, and that is why Mrs. Gandhi came up with the wheat revolution statement, and wheat revolution stamp was also issued. That was a time when India stopped, gradually stopped PL-480 imports. And the biggest objection when India stopped PL-488 was from the finance ministry. They never liked India stopping PL-480 imports. And that's what happens. You know, there's a lobby in India which is very happy with export-import. You know, that's where they make money. So they are always opposed to any imports stopping. So anyway, finance ministry had objected to it. Now, 10 years later down the line, after Green Revolution began, the negative impacts of Green Revolution began to be seen. What is subsequently called as the second generation environmental impacts. These became very prominent in those areas. But this is where the scientists forgot to going for what I call as midterm correction. You know, every time the finance minister presents a budget, 6 months down the line, he presents midterm corrections. Now, I thought the scientists should have also presented something called as midterm corrections. But they suggested to the farmers that whatever losses or whatever, the insect attack, more insect attack and more crop losses, all, they said you go in for more Green Revolution, which means more fertilizer, more pesticide, that's what was pumped in. So we have this problem exacerbating over the years, and of course now much of the suicide problem in this country is of course because of the credit equation going wrong, but that credit equation is going wrong because we have destroyed the natural resource base. Once you destroy the natural resource base, your cost of production has gone up phenomenally. Your output production, output price is not keeping pace. This is also interesting. If you look at globally, in the last 20 years, how the input prices have gone up. But the output price, whether in America or whether in India, has remained static. Studies by UNTAD show that the output price or the farm gate price all over the world in the last 20 years has remained frozen. Except for, if you adjust for inflation, the prices are frozen. If today in Bengal, the tomato is still selling at 60 paisa or 80 paisa or 1 rupee, 20 years earlier also it was almost the same if you have adjusted for inflation. Now that is something, you will agree, if the output price remains static, the input price has been rising phenomenally, plus because of the destruction of the natural resource base, the input's requirement has also gone up phenomenally. You require roughly double the amount of chemical fertilizers now to produce the same kind of crop that you were producing 10 years back. So that means your not only the quantity has gone up, your cost has gone up and so on, and that has added on to your burden, but the output price remains static. So the farmer has no choice but to commit suicide. If you and me, our income was to remain static for 20 years, I'm sure many of us would have committed suicide by now. So it is no exception that the farmers have committed suicide. And when we tell farmers that the best way to pull you out of this is that we going for FDI in retail, we going for contract farming, I can tell you we are bigger criminals than the poor farmers at whom we are trying to adjust to. That's very sad, very tragic that there's a lobby in India which works, as I said earlier, the scientists were working for the industry. There's a huge lobby of management consultants and then, you know, the economists who work only for the corporate sector. So they will have all the kinds of arguments that, you know, unless we bring in FDI in retail, the farmer in India would not gain. Now, FDI in retail is a different story. I can come to that later. But first, let us look at where we are today. Why is the farmer suffering out of the Green Revolution? And then what do we need to really bail him out? Do we need to extend that Green Revolution model to Eastern India? Or do we need to apply a different approach here? Now, let's look at that. Punjab is the seat of Green Revolution. Punjab produces roughly 50% of the surplus that the country produces. As was said earlier, the water requirement has never been computed in that form. For every liter, every kilo of wheat grain, you actually require 1,000 liters of water on an average. But I think the requirement for wheat actually is 3,000 liters. But if you take an average for all cereals, it is 1,000 liters. For rice, the average for producing 1 kilo of rice is, according to IRI, it is 5,000 liters. But according to me, it is 3,000 liters in India, maybe 5,000 liters in America, but even 3,000 liters. But when you grow hybrid rice, the water requirement goes up. Now, isn't it ironical that in a country which has 65% or 60% area under dryland agriculture, in all the dryland regions of India, we actually are growing crops which require more water. Common sense tells us that in dryland areas, we should be growing crops which require less water. I'm sure you'll all agree. But here in this country, in the dryland regions, we not only grow hybrid rice, we grow hybrid sorghum, hybrid bajra, hybrid maize, hybrid cotton, hybrid vegetables. Now, the requirement of water for hybrid crops is roughly 1.5 times that of the high-yielding varieties. In Punjab, where 99% area is assured under assured irrigation, we grow high-yielding varieties. But in Andhra Pradesh, we grow hybrid rice. In Bengal, of course, your water table is quite high, but now the thrust of the country is, or the Ministry of Agriculture, is to go hybrid across crops, across country, across regions in India. Not requiring, on the one hand, we talk of the destruction of the soil, destruction of the natural resource base. The hybrid crop production is higher, productivity is higher because it requires more fertilizer, more pesticides, more water. But somehow we believe that, you know, the argument is that, you know, we have to meet the population growth in this country. Again, that's another area which has been used by the industry and the economists to again confuse us with this argument. What is the population of the globe?
7 billion.
What is the food that we produce today? You'll be surprised that the food that we produce today globally is good enough to feed 11.5 billion people. And what is the population going to be in 2050?
9 billion.
Why should we worry about food production? We already are producing 11.5 billion globally. In terms of calories, if you look at the report that you mentioned, IASTD, if you look at that report, the report says very clearly the average calorie requirement, you know, per capita is about 2,400 calories. You can say 2,600 calories. But what is being produced today, what is available to you, is 4,600 calories. So where is the shortage of food? The only thing is that instead of focusing on all these, you know, productivity jargons, what we need to do is we should go in for access and distribution. It's a critical issue. Let's try to address that critical issue, how to distribute it equitably across regions, across people, across communities. Nobody wants to do it. One part of the world is eating more, one part of the world is left to starve. Now, if you look at America, compare America with India. America, as I said earlier, has 320 million people as population. India has 320 million people who go to bed hungry every night. Now, in America, 62% of the population is clinically obese. In India, 62% population is malnourished. Now, there are more weight reduction clinics in America than there are ration shops in India. Now these are the kinds of models that are existing. Why can't we ensure that that part of the world also starts taking that food requirement in a judicial way? And I think as that Guardian report said recently, that you know, when global warming impact will be visible, then the world will go vegetarian. But I don't wait for that. Let's try to work now. Why can't we ensure that the equitable distribution in a manner that every country produces its for itself? I think it's a very important argument. Now, nevertheless, this argument that India also needs to produce more is again flawed. Is again flawed because, as was mentioned by Professor Bhargava in the morning, in 2001 to 2003, India had a record surplus of grain in India, food grains, wheat and rice, 60 million tons on an average within those 3 years, Dr. Bhargava. 60 million tons. There was a study done, very interesting. It said, how much is 60 million tons? Because we Indians, including me, we are very fond of tossing around figures, not even knowing how much it would mean in absolute terms. Now, if you look at 60 million tons, you know, if you were to keep one bag of grain, another bag of grain over it, another bag of grain over another bag of grain, if you were to stack it like this, you could actually walk up to the moon and come back. Now, that was the quantity of food lying in India in 2001-2003, and we had still 320 million people going to bed hungry. And what did India do? I didn't find any agriculture scientist association. They always talk of increase in their salaries, but they never raise this question, why can't we distribute this food to our poor? And this food is nutritious. I'm sure you will agree. That food, 60 million tons, was nutritious. Wheat, the average protein requirement, protein availability in wheat is about 9 to 11% protein is there in wheat. In case of rice, it's much less, 6 to 7. But in any case, that is the kind of wheat, nutritious food that was lying within the country. And what did India do? It exported much of it outside at below the poverty line price. It didn't feed its people. And when you export food out of its country, it's a very fascinating, again, look at the development model. An American company called RiceX, it developed a product called, I don't know what it's called, it is patented product, and they had actually converted rice husk into human nutritious food, made it into pellets, and they offered it to India, and Monsanto collaborated with that RiceX company to set up a 200 million plant in Karnataka to provide Indians with that patented nutritious food, because India has the largest population of malnourished in the world. India was very happy. Economic times and business standards were also very happy because we were getting 200 million tons of investment. I stood up and challenged at that time. I said, what a remarkable model of development. Rice husk is traditionally used as cattle feed. You are converting cattle feed for a human nutritious food. And in India, you have rice plus wheat, which is the human nutritious food. When you export it, you actually export it for the cattle of the Western countries. So your own nutritious food goes for the cattle of the Western countries. Their cattle feed comes into India as human nutritious food. What a remarkable model of development. And eventually, that project got stalled. RiceX company has never pardoned me for getting that stalled in India. But I was so happy that that debate generated in India that this was not the development model that you require. Food is lying in front of you and you don't know how to distribute it. Now this year in June 1, the food stocks that we have is 82.4 million tons. 82.4 million tons means that after even going up to the moon, you still have 20 million tons left. Now that's the kind of surplus you have in this country. Why do you need to raise your productivity still higher? I want to ask you this question. If you can't even know how to handle 82 million tons, why do you need to raise productivity? Let us first focus on distributing. No, that's what I'm saying. Why can't we distribute that food? Learn to distribute that food. And if you provide that demand, farmers would grow more food. They don't grow more food because there's no demand. There are no takers for it. Even with the existing system, they can do it. Now, this brings me to another question. The argument is that productivity in Green Revolution went up because we had the dwarf varieties coming. I strongly challenge that. It was not a fact. It was not a fact. Why I'm saying this is, just think over it. And I leave it to you to answer, to think over it, brood over it for some time. You know, when the Green Revolution varieties came in, as I said earlier, when the tractor comes in, it comes with a package. So when the Green Revolution varieties came in, they also came with a package. And Swaminathan agrees with me, if Green Revolution had not come with two planks of the strategy, what he calls as famine avoidance strategy, there would have been no increase in the crop yield. The two strategies were, when the productivity goes up, at the time of the harvest, the prices will crash. So once the price crash, the farmer has no incentive to go into the same crop again. So which means the Green Revolution, the increase, the quantum jump that you envisage, would not be sustainable, because farmer is not going to go for it unless he gets the cost that he, or plus the price he can get from them. That is why they set up the Agriculture Prices Commission. The second plan was that if you provide at the time of the harvest, they're going to be glut. Now, if you don't manage that glut, again the prices are going to clash. It's only the trade which is going to benefit. So, what is the use of that kind of regulation? So, they set up the Food Corporation of India. So, these two plans, the mandis and the Food Corporation of India, actually did the magic. If you withdraw these, green revolution collapses. The argument that I would like to ask present before you, ladies and gentlemen, is before the green revolution came, the productivity was not going up. But just imagine if the government of India had focused on providing a better price to farmers and a short price to farmers, and also providing a mandi or the FCI to the farmers, the production would have gone up. Just think of it. Look at Bengal. Bengal has the same kind of situation that the country has. You don't have mandis. All these years you don't have mandis. Your production fluctuates, rice production. But if you want to provide a network of mandis like Punjab has, despite your green revolution bread, the point I'm trying to make is green revolution bread is already there. Despite that, your production is not showing that quantum jump. But if you were to provide, let's say tomorrow, open up a network of mandis across the state, your production will jump. Because farmers get an assured market. That's what they need. They don't need BT crops or GM crops and all. What they need is an assured market. Give them an assured market where they know that, like you and me, every month they will get an income. They will be very happy investing in that crop. And that's what they have done in Punjab. In Punjab, the number of mandis is phenomenal. Every 10 kilometers, you have a mandi. In fact, one of the greatest achievements of somebody called as M.S. Randhawa, if you remember the great Indian agricultural scientist and one of the first vice chancellors of Punjab Agriculture University, M.S. Randhawa, a great connoisseur of art also. I remember asking him once, as to how the Green Revolution was, this entire mandi structure was built up. He said there was a chief minister, Lakshman Singh, who became chief minister in Punjab just for 6 months. He knew he's going to last only for 6 months. He was an illiterate man. So after swearing in, the next 2-3 days, he drove to Randhawa's place and asked him, "Doctor sir, I want to do something in my 6 months so that my name is completely embedded in history." So Randhawa said, "The best you can do is, Punjab has the potential, they have the mandis, but the problem is, the farmer can't take his produce to the mandis because there are no roads. So you provide the link roads." He laid down the entire network of link roads in Punjab. Today, every mandi in Punjab is linked. You 10 kilometers, you know how to take it on your tractor. You can easily go to it. That's the kind of network they're providing in Punjab. That is why Punjab, you don't find distress sale happening. In Bengal, it's always distress sale. You rarely get procurement price being achieved by the farmers here. Why? Because you haven't provided the farmers with mandis. So the essence is, don't go in for anything else. I think you don't need second green revolution. You don't need any other thing. What you need is just to provide a network of mandis, provide them the remunerative price, they will do the rest. That's what Bengal needs, that's what Bihar needs. I was telling Nitish Kumar a month back that if you really want to do something in your state, try to build up a network of mandis. And Mayawati, you can blame her for everything. Before she left her position, she actually has set aside money for 2,000 mandis in eastern India, in eastern UP. I think that's a remarkable step Mayawati has taken. I think she understood that the FDI in retail is not the answer. The answer is the mandis that we must have. So she has done it. So what I'm all saying is that in your state, what is required is a network of mandis, and you don't have to follow the same mistake that Punjab has done by way of green revolution, because it is now established. NASA studies, Department of Soil studies in Punjab, numerous other studies, there are 138 development blocks in Punjab, out of which 108, the water requirement there has already reached dark zone, which means 98% exploitation. Now this is the level of Punjab. In 2020, the expectation of Punjab Agriculture University is that the withdrawal of water would be in minus terms. There will be no water to withdraw in Punjab. Now that's not the stage that we would like Bengal to get into. I think what we need is not a Eastern Green Revolution model, which basically is harboring upon pushing that technology. The input provider is the gainer, fertilizer, pesticide, seed, machines. That's what the machines, the companies will gain. The scientists will gracefully retire. They don't have to worry about farmers. But the fact of the matter is the farmer will bear the cost for all times to come. Now what we need is exactly what Andhra Pradesh has done. Andhra Pradesh in the last 6 years, what began from a village, Panukula, in the Khammam district of Andhra Pradesh, they first stopped using pesticides. Non-pesticide management they began to. And after stopping use of pesticide, today, as I was saying, let me get that figure, 35 lakh acres in Andhra Pradesh is today without pesticides, out of which 20 lakh is also without chemical fertilizers now. So no chemical fertilizer and no pesticides, less of chemical fertilizer. Look at the food security situation going up. Look at the livelihood security going up. Look at the health cost getting reduced in Andhra Pradesh. That's the model of agriculture that Bengal needs to adopt. It is not the green revolution mold that we need to push in East India, including Bengal. So we need a shift. We need a paradigm shift here to understand what has gone wrong there. Are we going to commit the same mistakes that, you know, that have been done across the country, across the world, and across, of course, the society all these years? Scientific community has to come in terms now to see that, you know, we are able to build up a system which is sustainable. As somebody said that, you know, the bigger problem today is global warming. It's very shocking that whenever I go to a global warming conference, I hear that how should farmers adapt to the changing environment? You know, we are not telling how the agriculture has actually changed that environment. Nobody talks about it. 25% of greenhouse gas emissions come from agriculture. Why can't we do away with that, you know, greenhouse gas emissions? Much of it comes from chemical fertilizers and pesticides. Why can't we reduce that greenhouse gas emission instead of asking farmers to adapt to the changing environment? I think the bigger challenge is to get away from that mold of greenhouse, you know, the agriculture, which not only intensifies but also adds on to the global warming and the greenhouse gases and so on. And please, let's not forget, is also an agriculture which brings in farmers to commit suicide. In those areas where the NPM model is being followed in Andhra Pradesh, so far there has been no suicide. If it can happen in the 35 lakh acres, I am sure it can happen in Bengal also. And don't tell me that Bengal doesn't have farmer suicides. It's only that the previous government didn't allow those figures to come out. You know, they were always very clear that these figures will not come out. I remember I did a survey in this country of farmer suicide across the country. And the only state which I could not get figure, my researcher said he would be killed if he were to come out with those figures, was Bengal. But that was the kind of terror that existed in this part of the country. I'm not blaming a party A or party B, but that was also the reality. The point I'm trying to make, ladies and gentlemen, is we have to now come to a system of agriculture which is locally based upon local production, based upon local procurement, and also based upon local distribution. Now, that's the model of agriculture that Bengal needs to adopt. And I think Dendu has already shown a model of local distribution, you know, where they have the grain banks. And I'm a great votary of grain banks across the country. This is what we actually need to provide food security to local households, to the poor households. And that model of agriculture, we have the examples across the country, and we can build up that. And I think Bengal can usher in a new era of agriculture.